see all of you here tonight. I'm really pleased. And I wanted to start by saying that I'm not related to Captain Kidd, Billy the Kid, Bruce Kidd, or any other famous or infamous kid, but I am a new kid on the block, as Prim said, and I'm very happy to be back in Ontario. I'm from Sarnia originally, but I've been in New Brunswick for the last 15 years. So, thank you so much, and thank you to Prem for the invitation to come here tonight. So, I will be giving you an overview about some sort of older contaminant issues and then some of the newer contaminant issues. And it's really a taste of what's going on and some of our newer understanding about our exposures around contaminants and some of the ongoing and emerging issues related to wildlife health, human health, and fish health. So I'm going to talk first about legacy contaminants. What are they? How do we get exposed to them? Where are they used? What happens when they're released into the environment? And then some global actions to reduce their use because of their toxicity. Then I'll move to some emerging issues, some newer water-related issues that we're becoming more and more concerned about. And the one I'll focus mainly on is around pharmaceuticals and municipal wastewaters, and you may be familiar with that from some of the recent press coverage around antidepressants in fish, for example. And then I'll talk about some next steps and where I think we need to go around this issue. So legacy contaminants are really chemicals that have been very heavily used, starting in the 1940s. And they've been used as pesticides and consumer products and industrial processes. And these are chemicals that were designed to be very persistent, very resistant to heat, very effective pesticides. And they have properties that make them accumulate in the environment. So they build up, and some of them will last for decades once they're released into our waters and soils. And they have properties, as I'll show you shortly, where they concentrate up through food webs to potentially toxic levels. And many of them have been banned by what's known as the Stockholm Convention. And I'll show you later in the talk how effective this convention's been at reducing the levels of these legacy contaminants in the environment. So here's a few examples. I've shown some molecules here, PCBs. PVDEs, DDT, and HVCDD, and these are just some examples of legacy contaminants that we've been concerned about. And if you look at the molecules, they have a few things in common. One of them is that they're quite large. Another one is that they have either bromines or chlorines on them, and that's what makes them very resistant to bacterial breakdown or breakdown from sunlight in the environment. And DDT is probably one you've heard, you're most familiar with, and that was used heavily as an insecticide on crops and on forests that were being infested by a spruce bugworm, for example. We still use it to control malaria because it's the most effective way to fight against that disease. PCBs and flame retardants have been very heavily used in electronics, for example. PCBs were used in capacitors and transformers and paints, a lot of different building materials. And these flame retardants on the bottom were very heavily used in building materials as well as furniture. And this isn't a piece of cheesecake, it's a piece of foam. I guess I'm hungry because it looks like cheesecake to me, but it was used because they're very effective at reducing flammability of furniture, for example, or buildings. So what happens when we either apply these chemicals purposely in the environment as a pesticide, or they're worn off of products or released from industrial activities? They either go up into the atmosphere where they can be carried by wind currents to remote locations such as the Arctic, or they're released in rivers from industries or from municipal wastewaters where they can build up through food webs. So we know that these chemicals are transported globally and that there are no areas of the planet that are uncontaminated by these legacy contaminants. And this is an example from a report on mercury, and it just shows you the hatched areas on the map are showing you high areas of high mercury emissions. And then the red and blue arrows are showing where mercury is circulated globally once it's released into the atmosphere or into our oceans. So these kinds of chemicals move quite rapidly around the planet and result in contamination of even very remote locations. And what I focus a lot on in my research program and what we're very concerned about with these legacy contaminants is this buildup of their levels through the food web. So you get an increase in the levels of legacy contaminants as you move from the plants and algae that support the base of the food web up to the insects that eat the algae, up to the fish that eat those insects and the fish that eat those fish, and then mammals like us that may eat those fish. So that concentration can result in very high levels of legacy contaminants. So one of the things that we're starting to understand more and more is that our exposures to these chemicals are very similar to the exposures for wildlife and human and fish. And so when we look at where legacy contaminants come from for things like a polar bear or a fish, we know that most of it comes from their diet. So what's in their bodies is really affected by what they're eating. It's also affected by how long they live, where they live as well. And one route of exposure that's a particular concern for marine mammals is either exposure in the womb or exposure through breast milk. And once these chemicals get into the body tissues, they're stored mainly in fats because they have that property, they have a fat-loving property. So for humans, there are lots of different ways that we get exposed to chemicals, but for these legacy chemicals, our route of exposure is also very similar to that of fish and wildlife. So we take it up mainly from our food. I'll show you shortly, there's also a newer route of exposure for flame retardants dusts that we're knowing we are recognizing as increasingly important. And then, like marine mammals, we're exposed to these chemicals in the womb as well as through breast milk. And there can be many different sources of chemical exposure, but for legacy contaminants, it's mainly through food. And like for fish and wildlife, our exposures can vary with our age, with where we live, what we eat, and as well as where we work. And they're stored in fats. So I'll just show you a few examples of some monitoring that's been done in humans and wildlife to hopefully convince you that our exposures are similar to those of wildlife. And this is a map of the planet, and the bars on the map are showing the levels of a flame retardant in bird eggs. And these are eggs that have been collected from a number of locations around the world. And this is a flame retardant that's quite common in foams in your couch. And what you see when you look at North America compared to Europe and Asia is that the bird eggs in North America have much higher levels of these flame retardants than anywhere else on the planet. And that's because in North America we have very strict flammability standards, so we use a lot more of these flame retardants in our products than they do elsewhere. And when you look at humans, you see exactly the same pattern. So these are levels of flame retardants in blood of people living in North America on the left, and Europe, Australia, New Zealand, and Asia in the middle and right. And you can see how much higher the box is for the people in North America than anywhere else on the planet. So our exposure to these flame retardants is higher because we use more of them in our products. And similarly, wildlife exposure is higher. And another newer source of contaminants now is e-waste. So when we dispose of our cell phones, our computers, They're often taken to these e-waste disposal sites, and many of which are in developing countries or countries with economies in transition like China. They're uncontrolled waste sites, and there's people that work at these sites to remove the recyclable materials. And the graph here is showing the levels of another flame retardant in people that either work at the e-waste site, so the far left bar, or they live in the e-waste area, which is the next bar to the right, or they live away from the e-waste area. And the graph shows you that if you're working or living near the e-waste site, your exposure to these flame retardants is higher, as is your exposure to other chemicals as well, plasticizers, metals, PCBs, other things that are in our electronics. And we also know that things like cow's milk is higher in these flame retardants when the cows are living near these e-waste sites. So people are getting exposed not just from occupations, but also through their diet. Fish and other wildlife are high in contaminants around e-waste sites too. So the patterns of exposure are very similar here as well. And we know very clearly from a number of excellent long-term studies that have been done, particularly out of Scandinavia, that the more of these chemicals we use, the higher the exposure, both in the environment and in humans. And this graph is of polar bear fat from Greenland. And the samples were collected before and during the beginning of the use of this flame retardant. And as our production of it increased, the levels in the polar bear fat increased. And we see exactly the same kind of trend in breast milk in women in Sweden as well, that the levels of this flame retardant go up the more we use this chemical. And I mentioned before that age is something that affects our exposure. So I'll just show you a few examples of that here. And this one goes back to my comment earlier about dust as a newer source of exposure. So what they did in this study is they compared children to mothers, and they looked at the levels of flame retardants in these paired mother and child. And they found that in the children, their levels were much higher, 3 to 6 times higher. And they think that's a lot to do with where children are. They're on the floor, they're often putting their hands in their mouths. So they're getting exposed to these chemicals because of their activities. And here's an example from polar bears that were collected north of Norway and Svalbard. And they're comparing the chemical levels in the polar bear cubs to the mothers. And so the mothers are in the darker bars, and the cubs, the young cubs, are in the lighter bars from 2 different years. And what they've seen very clearly is that the cubs have higher exposure of PCBs in this case than the mothers do. And I wanted to mention, I don't have time to go into this, but I know there's a lot of concern around human exposure, so I just wanted to mention that Health Canada has a long-term monitoring program that was started in 2007, Canadian Health Measures Survey, and they just recently released the fourth report. And they measure levels of chemicals in Canadians, about 2,500 Canadians, every 3 years or so. So they've done this 4 times now. And they're looking for trends in our exposure, levels of concern. So if you're interested, there's a lot of information on the website around what they're finding in our blood and urine. The next point I wanted to make is that we're really not that different from fish and marine mammals. And this is around how chemicals are affecting our bodies. And I wanted to go back to a really early, very serious case of poisoning from mercury. And this is it's from Minamata, Japan. And this is a small fishing community that relied very heavily on the bay as a source of fish. there was a chemical company that was releasing mercury into the bay, and that mercury was concentrating through the food web, and people were getting exposed to it through their diet. And there's been a lot of work around this mercury poisoning because of this, but I'll just read you this quote here because it makes a really interesting point that citizens noticed that many of the town's cats, rats, crows, and fish behaved strangely. For no apparent reason, they exhibited frenzied behavior, throwing themselves against stone walls, staggering as though intoxicated, and frequently hurling themselves into Minamata Bay, where many drowned. So this was in 51. They were noticing fish kills, cats circling, and birds falling from the sky. And then in 1956, that was the first time that they really started noticing that people were exhibiting very similar effects from the mercury exposure. So they were developing Minamata disease, which is the effects of the mercury on the nervous system. So they were having troubles walking and talking and hearing, so motor coordination was failing, and developing numbness and tremors. And this is a very sobering example of, had we paid more attention to what was happening to the fish, the cats, the rats, and the birds early on, that maybe a lot of human suffering could have been avoided. But it's also a very clear example of how a chemical can have very similar effects on humans, fish, and other mammals. Well, cats and rats here, and birds as well. The next example is around Baltic seals, and these seals were developing fibroids. These female seals were developing fibroids that are a lot like the fibroids that we women develop in mid-age, and that can cause problems with fertility. And what they saw, these black bars you see sort of peak, you probably can't read that, but the numbers of seals with these fibroids really peaked in the 70s and 80s, right at the same time as their exposure to PCBs was peaking as well. So there's very strong evidence that higher exposure to PCBs led to more female seals with these fibroids, and the ones that had a lot of fibroids were unable to reproduce, so the seal population in the Baltic started to decline. And it's since recovering because the PCB levels are going down, so that's a good news story, but there are a lot of similarities here. We're not sure that fibroids in women are caused by PCBs, but it's suggestive that there may be some similar underlying causes, underlying relationships to environmental exposures. And then the other example is around thyroid diseases and disorders. So you probably know of someone that has low thyroid hormone levels that causes you to be tired, lethargic, cold. Many people are taking thyroid hormones. And there's also been an increase in thyroid cancers since the 1970s in humans. Based on some lab studies with animals, as well as some long-term epidemiological studies, they're increasingly linking problems with thyroid hormone and thyroid cancers to exposures to PCBs and other legacy contaminants. And in wildlife, we see similar types of relationships. So there are a lot of studies now showing that birds with higher exposure to PCBs have lower thyroid levels as well. So far, so good?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The other thing that has emerged in this field more recently is that early exposures are very critical. So when you're exposed to legacy contaminants in the womb or as an infant or as a young child, that can result in diseases later in life. So what this figure is showing here is exposures that happen at a young age can lead to obesity over the lifetime, altered puberty, fibroids, prostate cancer, and Alzheimer's later in life, cardiovascular disease, breast cancer, and some learning disorders and asthma. So what happens is exposure can change tissue programming, and we may not see it early on, but later in life there can be increasing incidences of these diseases because of these early life exposures. So I wanted to bring you some positive news. I didn't want to be all heavy tonight. So there's been a lot of good that's been happening around international actions on these legacy chemicals. One of them is the Stockholm Convention that's banning or severely restricting the use of these legacy PCBs. And here's an example of another PCB, or not another legacy contaminant in fish from the Baltic that was going up over time. And then there's a graph showing you the levels of this. It's a stain repellent that was used in Scotchgard. The levels of this stain repellent in blood of men from Norway, you know, as this chemical was being used and then after it was banned. So these conventions have been really effective at reducing our exposures over time. And the fish, I think, are just taking a little bit longer to show that because the environmental, the environmental store of this chemical is larger. And this is a better example. The graphs are these four panels for four different legacy contaminants. Here, this is a pesticide on the top left, another a breakdown product of DDT on the top right, PCBs on the bottom left, and then another insecticide on the bottom right. And there's little insets for each of those panels that shows you the use of our use of these chemicals. So all of them have declined in use in recent years. And then the larger parts of the graph are showing you the time trends of these chemicals in guillemot eggs. And guillemot are a fish-eating bird. So very clearly, the Stockholm Convention and the ban of these chemicals has reduced exposures for these birds. And another convention that I'm super excited about because we work a lot on mercury in my lab is the Minamata Convention that just came into force this year, this August. And so this is a global treaty that's going to reduce our use of mercury in household products and the release of mercury from coal fire generating stations and its use in gold mining. And as a result, we're going to see reductions in our exposure to mercury as well. So what are some newer and emerging chemical issues? Well, the one I'm focusing on tonight is this issue around pharmaceuticals and municipal wastewaters. But it's part of a bigger issue of what's in the products that we use on our daily basis, the toothpaste, the soaps, the shampoos, cosmetics. And when we use these products, like when we are taking pharmaceuticals, they're excreted by our bodies and then flushed down the toilet. They go to municipal wastewater treatment plants, and not all of them are broken down. And that's because wastewater treatment plants weren't designed to break these chemicals down. Some of them certainly are broken down fortuitously, I guess, but a lot of them are released in the effluents into our rivers. And so I'm just going to talk quickly about an experiment that I led when my first career was with Fisheries and Oceans Canada as a research scientist. So I'll talk very briefly about this experiment where we added the pill to a whole lake. And why did we dose the lake with the pill? Well, there were a lot of studies coming out in the 90s saying that fish living downstream of wastewater discharges, the male fish were becoming feminized. And what I mean by that is the males were developing eggs in the more severe cases, or they were producing egg proteins. And lots of follow-up studies were done, and they linked it to the release of estrogens in municipal wastewater. So we women that are on the pill are excreting the estrogen in the pill along with natural estrogens that are getting released in the effluents, and those male fish are taking them up through the gills, and that's causing them to become feminized. Oh, and so the big question for our experiment was, does that matter? Can you still have feminized male fish in the population and sustain the population? And I just wanted to say that we have, our scientific community has done a number of studies across Canada to look for feminized male fish. And there's been some found in the South Saskatchewan River, in Wascana Creek in Saskatchewan, in the St. Lawrence River downstream of Montreal, and then also in the Grand River. So I'll just zoom in on the Grand River study. But first, I should mention too that there's a common theme to these studies, and that you tend to find these feminized male fish in areas where there's less dilution of the wastewater, there's less treatment of the wastewater, and there's higher populations. So higher exposure of the fish to these estrogens. And in the Grand River, so if you imagine this is a fish that's been cut open, it's a darter here, and when you look in the inside, the white, that's testes, so that's normal male tissues. And then in this very severe case, the yellow objects, those are eggs. So this is a fish that has been very severely feminized. And in this study that was led by Mark Servaz from the University of Waterloo, 60% of the males had this condition downstream of a wastewater treatment plant. And this is what it looks like on the inside. The big, when you section the testes, you see those big round objects, those are eggs in amongst the sperm cells. So we did this whole lake experiment at a fantastic facility called the Experimental Lakes Area. And this is an area in northwestern Ontario that's been set aside for whole lake experiments, and it's been used to very successfully influence legislation around acid rain and phosphates and detergents, for example. And what we did is we chose a lake called Lake 260, and this is just some specs on it. So it's quite a large lake. It has trout in it and a lot of different kinds of small fish species. We dosed the lake by basically pumping the estrogen into the propeller wash and driving the boat around the lake. So we'd add it three times a week. It took us about 15 minutes each time to add the estrogen in the pill. And then we started to look for effects on the fish themselves. And what happened, we focused a lot on this small fish called the fathead minnow, and it's called the fathead minnow because when it's reproducing, it has a fat head. And if the males in this species right away started to produce egg proteins, and shortly, about a year after we started this experiment, they developed eggs. So this is a cross-section of a normal male here on the left, and then on the right is a male that's starting, well, it's developed eggs. It's showing the same kind of condition that we see in the Grand River that was seen in Europe initially. And then what happened to the fish numbers? Well, this is a synopsis of that too. So when we looked at both the young fish and the adults, and this first graph is the young fish, within a year, the number of young fish declined really dramatically by about 99% compared to the lake, the reference lake we were using. And we saw the same kind of trend with the adults. It just took a bit longer for their population numbers to crash as well. So there was a reproductive failure, and then eventually we almost caused a near extinction of this species from the lake. So we learned a lot. I mean, there's a lot of other results that I won't talk about today, but the main lessons were that the pill is as effective for fish as it is for humans. The fish population recovered once we stopped adding the estrogen to the lake, so that was great news, that you could actually expect recovery of systems once you removed estrogens from wastewaters. These whole lake experiments are invaluable because we never could have done this in the lab and seen these kinds of results. And the final one, I've said this already, is that we're really not that different from fish, and that's because the hormones that we use to control our reproduction are quite similar to the ones that fish use to control their reproduction.
Sorry, quick question.
Yes.
Why is there no change in the white sucker if it's still a fish?
It's because of where it was living in the lake mainly, and that some species are just less sensitive to estrogens than others. Yep. So I wanted to mention another good news story, aside from the fathead minnow recovering in our lake. This is just a recent study that came out again from Mark Servos' lab at the University of Waterloo. They've been following these feminized male fish in the Grand River for years. And what they did is they continued to follow the fish after the Kitchener wastewater treatment plant underwent upgrades. So they put in a nitrifying sludge system in 2012, and what they found was that, unexpectedly, because the system was not, it was designed to convert ammonia, which is quite toxic, to nitrates, which is less toxic, but as a happy byproduct of that upgrade, the estrogens in the wastewater went down. The fish living downstream were getting exposed to less estrogens, and the male fish, the feminized male fish, it went from about 70 to 100% abundance of those feminized males down to less than 10%. Within about 3 years of that upgrade happening. So it's fantastic. I love this story. It's a really good news one that these kinds of investments have a lot of benefits. So some of my final thoughts, that we're a society that's really dependent on chemicals, and that's not going to change. So we, since the 1930s, we've developed and used over 140,000 different chemicals. And our global production of chemicals continues to increase. And it's increasing especially in developing countries. And that's what this figure is showing you, from 1970 on the far left to 2010 or 2020, which is the estimated production of chemicals in developing countries, you can see this rapid increase. And so there's more and more awareness that we need to use and produce these chemicals with sound management to reduce risks to human health and fish and wildlife health. And we do have the technologies available. The good news is that when they've been used in developed countries, they've been very effective at reducing exposures and reducing risks. And I also wanted to mention, too, that we have the Sustainable Development Goal 3.9 to substantially reduce the number of deaths and illnesses related to chemical exposure. So, globally, there's this will to do better with chemical production and use. So we have reduced exposures in developed countries, but there's still a lot more to do, especially in developing countries and those with economies in transition. And while we understand the health risks of some of these chemicals, like the legacy ones I talked about, but most of the chemicals that are in use today, we have very little understanding of their health risks. So we need a much better understanding of that. Our greatest concerns, and I'm talking collectively, are around developing countries because there's less legislation, less oversight around the production and use of these chemicals in developing countries. And the greatest concerns are also for the poor and for the very young. So developing countries have fewer safeguards around chemical production and disposal. We know that the fetus and young, both in humans and wildlife, are most susceptible to chemical exposure. And the poor are at greatest risk because they're the ones that tend to live near landfills or industrial sites. They live in substandard housing where their exposure to lead-based paints may be higher. They may live near industries that produce and release chemicals, or near sites where waste is burned and heavy traffic as well. So finally, there's an approach that I wanted to mention that I think will be really valuable as it's gaining momentum. And the figure here is really showing the connection between healthy people, healthy environment, and healthy animals. So this is called the One Health Approach. And it's really a movement to try and bring people like myself that work on environmental health together with human health researchers and domestic animal health researchers to get a much better understanding of all of our exposures and health and chemical related disease and disorders. And I think it'll be highly effective because in that way we could share information around what we're finding. And as I hope I've convinced you that we're not that different from fish and wildlife and domestic animals, certainly. So the more we can do these kinds of integrative studies, the better off we'll be. And my last slide, just to mention that we're getting increasingly aware of how much of the global disease burden is related to pollution. And so they estimated in 2015 that 9 million deaths were pollution related. And that's all types of pollution, mostly air pollution and poor drinking water. So a lot of deaths are related to people not having clean drinking water and being exposed to high air pollution levels. But some of that, those deaths, about up to 1 million is an estimate, are related to the exposures to toxic chemicals. And just in October, there's this great paper that came out by the Lancet Commission that's linking human health to environmental health and pollution. And some of their recommendations, and I hope this report gets a lot of recognition and awareness, is that we really need to make pollution prevention, we need to move it up on the agenda, make it a higher priority at all levels of government in all countries around the world. We need much better systems to monitor pollution and the health-related effects that it causes, not just for humans, but also for wildlife. There's a need for more research, especially integrative research around health effects of pollution. And then more support and collaborations around technologies to reduce the release of pollution into the environment. So I'll just end by saying, at least for the research side of my talk, there's been a lot of support from different funding agencies. Thank you so much for your attention, and my email's at the bottom if you have any questions, or I'd be happy to answer them now if we have time. Thank you.